Okay, happy birthday, Mr. Hundertwasser. It is the, is it the 6th? No, the 15th of December, 2021. And there are three architects we pay homage today. Both very interesting and important. Hundertwasser was actually a painter, then Oscar Niemeyer, the celebrated Brazilian architect, and Joseph Hoffmann, the equally important Austrian architect, all born on December 15th, but in different years. So let's begin with, I have some difficulties to pronounce his first name, so I will just use his last name, Hundertwasser. Let's talk a little bit about him. So Friedrich Stowasser, apparently he changed his name, better known by his pseudonym, God, you know. It's quite a long name. I just read the family name. Hundertwasser was an Austrian visual artist and architect who also worked in the field of environmental protection. I wish more architects would work in the same field. I don't know so many working in that field, but it seems Hundertwasser was a visionary indeed, because he predicted what would happen later. He died 21 years ago. And yet, until he died, he was preoccupied by what is called environmental protection. Just for this, and I think he deserves our homage. Hundertwasser stood out as an opponent of a straight line. Hello. In other words, an opponent of the T-square and the rectangle, and any standardization, expressing this concept in the field of building design. His best known work is the Hundertwasser House in Vienna, Austria, which has become a notable place of interest in the Austrian capital, characterized by imaginative vitality and uniqueness. So let's read again. This man who didn't use computers was an opponent of what is called a straight line. Well. I would say that the straight line is not by definition, vicious. No, there was great architecture done with straight lines, drawn by freehand or with its majesty, the T-square and the rectangle. So in itself, the straight line is not, the enemy of everything. What is the enemy of everything is to remain stuck, to claim that only straight line is valuable in architecture, and only, of course, the T-square and the rectangle, although, as is known, I'm talking about something which some people might not even know what they mean, because for 30 years, humanity, worked distancing itself from the T-square and the rectangle, but not in the country where I am in now. Anyway, his adopted surname is based on the translation of Sto, the Slavic word for 100, into German. So essentially his name, his family name is something like, 100 waters. The name Friedensreich has a double meaning as peace realm or peace rich in the sense of peaceful. Therefore, his name Friedensreich Hundertwasser translates directly into English as peace realm 100 water. Now this makes me think a little bit of Creedence Clearwater Revival. Now the other names he chose for himself, Regenstadt and Dunkelbund, translate to rainy day and darkly multicolored. Beautiful. Here is a man of imagination who understood that the name says something and should say something. this makes me think of a beautiful film by Akira Kurosawa, the Bodyguard, which I truly recommend to anyone who wants to see a beautiful film by a great film director about a samurai who also at one moment was asked, what is your name? And he looks through the window of the room where he was in, and he saw some fields with flowers, and he names himself with the names of those flowers and the field of those flowers. Very beautiful, but this requires some poetical imagination and turn of the mind, which not too many people these days have, unfortunately. So let's see what the darkly multicolored man built and did. This is the man, part of him. Hello, Mr. Hundertwasser. Maybe he is here in Australia. Understood he left Austria at one moment, or Europe, and he settled in Australia. I like him. He's modest, but he did some remarkable things. And even if, you know, my personal preferences are not necessarily in towards such an architecture, I admire, you know, a man who is almost, you know, I mentioned this before, like Ishmael in the Bible, and his hand was against everybody's hand, and everybody's hand was against his. He was kind of like an Ishmael, you know, and before the year 2000s, he advocated environmental protection. Bravo to him. Drawings, some paintings, very colorful and very almost psychedelic and very, you know, hippie in a way. But you can tell this man loved nature, and in his own way of painting, he shows this. His architecture is very similar actually to his artworks. And this is a good thing, I would say. Now, of course, the professional architect would look with disdain at these artworks and would say, wait a minute, these are naive, they are infantile. Well, I am not so sure about it. His architecture, yes, does have some elements of a certain naivete, but isn't idealism itself, you know, rather naive? Often it is, unfortunately. Now, if this man tried to, you know, to enter a certain school of architecture and try to pass the examination, most surely would have failed, because his drawings were born from within, not from without, because of some prescriptions, how you are supposed to draw in order to pass the examination. Anyway, he remained true to himself. And he left something behind, and this is why we are wishing him today happy birthday, Mr. Hundertwasser. Now, if you look at these artworks, although in some of them you see some buildings, you wouldn't really expect this man to be also an architect and to build, and he built a lot. I mean, you know, most architects don't build so much as this painter built. Now, architecture, let's look at some of his buildings. Hundertwasser House in Vienna, in Austria, which is, you know, destination for many people, architects or tourists or passers-by, they all love to be here. There is also a great ice cream to be found across the street from this building. As you can tell, he was planting on various levels of the building, trees and so on, long before the fashion of today. So this man was a visionary. I mean, look at the building here on the right. Sorry, I don't know what happened. Yeah, here we has no green on it at all, while his building is almost becoming a garden or a vertical garden or a vertical forest, as now the saying goes. So he was you know, explicitly some kind of a visionary. As for the building itself, no architect trained seriously in a school of architecture would do something like this. No, not even Peter Cook. You know, he loved colors and he hated the straight line. I think we should have a discussion about this. You know, what is the relevance truly of this of Its Majesty the straight line? Yes, between culture and nature, there is a distance, it's true. But maybe that distance should be diminished if we are to bring back nature, and we need to do so badly in various ways. He is also not afraid of colors. Now, of course, most schools of architecture would not accept something like this. What do you mean? What's going on? You know, why is this not straight? Why is this yellow and this blue? You know, why? You know, but I don't know. The dogmatic form of education really agitates me and depresses me. So, well before the vertical forests of our time, look what he did here in Vienna. In Vienna, and I mean, there are more trees here, more vegetation than, you know, on many streets in Vienna. Maybe he was reacting, but I imagine these people living here, they enjoy having a little more ozone and so on. They are probably grateful to Hundertwasser. He has also some references. Actually, this kind of you know, architecture is to be seen in Vienna in various places, because Vienna was at one moment a destination for the Ottoman armies. They made it to there, and that, so there is an oriental touch, so to speak, in Viennese architecture. Look at this bathroom, you know, it's... again, if you do something like this in a school of architecture, you would be dismissed or considered mad or both. Oh, look here. But why not? Why not? Of course, work is needed for this, because, you know, it just to attach all these small pieces together here, you know, it's work. But what is the alternative? To watch TV on the comfortable sofa in your living room instead of doing this? Is it really so great? I think this is the place where or maybe I'm wrong. I bought ice cream from there, but I'm not sure, because this, where I bought the ice cream from, was across the street, but it looked very similar to this. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Yes, you would be most surely considered naive, you know, excessively picturesque, irrational. Yes, he was also irrational that he brought the trees at the top of the building. No, it was irrational because he wanted more ozone, you know, and he cared for the quality of the air. He was very irrational. No, while the owner of a proud car who provokes a lot of pollution on the highway or inside the city is not considered irrational. The world is really upside down. Could you be sent if you live in this building? It's possible. Yes, you can be sent anywhere. But I think the building is not that it is advocating, but through its colorfulness and being picturesque, probably it invites you, so to speak, to abstain from excessive melancholia or sadness. I don't know. I'm imagining. I didn't live in such a building, and I never will. Now the heating plant. This is a heating plant. It's a plant. It's a kind of a fact. It's an incinerator, actually. Look at this. An incinerator. I'm talking about this building, not this one. I had been here with the students in architecture, and they couldn't believe their eyes. Now, how could this be an incinerator? How could it be a plant? No, it's an industrial building. Well, why should an industrial building look, depressingly industrial? Why can't it be joyous? Even in this oniric way, why not? Again, this is not truly the architecture I admire the most, but I do admire his ingenuity, his imagination, his otherness. That's what we are talking about, otherness. You know, he did this sort of thing. He brought the trees here, up here, before anyone else. Now, of course, Jean Nouvel is doing, and many others, you know, Bjarke Ingels, everybody is planting trees everywhere. But Hundertwasser did it. I don't know when he built this, but it must be around, you know, like 30 years ago or so. He also brought on the elevations of the happy plant, you know, strawberries or, of course, the moralist, the so-called serious architect would say, this is nonsense. This is total nonsense. We won't take it. You know, we are serious people. We are professionals. We can't have this kind of primal, joy. No, that's not for us. That's him, no? It's his kind of hat. Yeah, but it is his hat. But very interesting. I saw this picture before, but it never occurred to me that it's actually his hat. What exactly is going on here, in this space, I don't know, but this is his hat. Funny. Anyway, interesting work, an incinerator. There is another interesting architect, Griffin, who built in Australia very interesting incinerators. The former collaborator of Frank Lloyd Wright, and I paid homage to him a while ago, not too long ago. Yeah. Now another building, this one in Germany. How come Germany, which obviously is very rigorous in so many respects, allowed a painter to build this fantasy work? Look at this. It's almost unbelievable, no? Well, they did. Because they're open-minded, you know? Even the Germans, they are open-minded. They are rigorous. Scrupulous, but you know, they experiment, they allow things to happen, and I'm sure these people who live here are probably maybe even thrilled of living in a different kind of building. Now this kind of terrace, you know, sloping terrace is being done now with a big publicity by Bjarke Ingels, you know, his project is published everywhere, except that Hundertwasser did it with at least 20 years earlier, if not more. And it must be enjoyable, actually, to work on this. Anyway. there are amazing things that happen in the world. And, you know, this man, Hundertwasser, is in his own way a phenomenon. The otherness of Hundertwasser is a reality. How could this be, you know, to have this kind of architecture built at the end of the, I imagine, at the end of the, I mean, no, it should have been at the end of the 20th century. He died in the year 2000. I'm not very thrilled about this, but then why not? You know, a reference, now this is Germany, it's not Austria. He has a liking for this sort of thing. It's a little bit, you know, facile for my moralist side, but I still like this ensemble of apartments. It's like a joyous citadel. He was a dreamer, but he was also a doer. You know, most people can't even afford to dream something like this. He not only dreamt of it, but he built it. Kunsthaus Wien in Vienna, similar to the other building that we saw. But you see how much is going on here on a, you know, essentially not a very large surface of this facade. There are many things happening here, you know, there is something to look at and to, you know, investigate. Most buildings, most modern buildings, there is nothing to investigate. But this is not the case here. I truly appreciate the city of Vienna, cosmopolitan, sophisticated, well-to-do city, being open to other forms of architectural expression, and not just architectural, but now we talk about architecture. Bravo to Vienna. Yes, bravo to Hundertwasser, but also bravo to Vienna. Also bravo to the town in Germany that built the previous work. And we are going to see a few other works by him. Yes, it's a dream world. It's almost a fantasy world. It's a fairy tale architecture. But I have to say, I had been here with architecture students. And all of them loved it. And they were trained in a very different kind of you know, architecture. Now a kindergarten in Frankfurt, again, Germany. Look at this. I think that the children would enjoy it. And they do enjoy it. Why does a kindergarten have to be in a sterile way, just a, you know, prismatic concrete box? You know. Would there be more joy there? I doubt it. That's the model. Even the model is delicious, perhaps too delicious. He could have made it, you know, actually to be able to eat it, you know, produce it in a pastry shop or something. And eat the model just like Kisho Kurokawa, who was very poor when he was a student. He used to make models of, you know, pasta, and after he presented the work, the model, or he photographed it, then he ate it. He cooked it and ate it, ate the model. Yes, that's very sustainable. I like this. This is a nice work. Yes, it's a little bit, but no, I mean, you know, especially here, it's a kindergarten, for God's sake, you know. I'm absolutely sure the kids love it. There is no reason not to. In fact, the mechanisms for fun, if I'm to describe them so, are more morose than the building itself. You see, the building is welcoming nature on top of it. Again, long before this was done, like it is down now. Now, a motorway restaurant in this place in Austria, you see the cars and you see the building. At the edge of the highway, you know, on the side of the highway. Well, if there were here 50 students in architecture, I would have told them, please don't try to do this in school unless you want to fail the project. Because if you do something like this in this school here, you most certainly fail miserably because it would not be understood, this kind of work. What are you doing here? Where do you think you are? Hot Springs Village, again in Austria, in Styria. They probably do that, the famous bike there, the Styria bikes. I love those bikes. And look what he did here. This beautiful madman called Hundertwasser, 100 waters. But you know, it could be misleading. You could say, yes, he did it here because it's a spa. No, he did this kind of architecture in the center of Vienna, in Frankfurt. He didn't just entertain here the people who came to the spa. It's the same kind of architecture. He didn't change. And I think it's very imaginative. Yes, you could say it's rather naive or... you know, the morose existentialist would be a little bit judgmental, but I think it has virtues. You know, in its own dreamy way, is advocating something else, a different kind of world, very different. Now, of course, we could all say this is too infantile for us. We are in the 21st century. We have the atomic bomb. We are, you know, we have the internet. We want to go to the moon. Don't try to seduce us, Mr. Hundertwasser, with this fairy tale, because we are not going to fall for it. You know, we don't. We are not children any longer. You know, we. But I wonder if the most, dry intellect somewhere, somehow, it's a little bit of a sympathy for this. I don't know. Now a church, again, in the same place, I mean, in Styria, it's a church, a joyous church. Look at it. Is it a judgmental church? Well, maybe not so much. I mean, how could you be very judgmental if you look at what we look at now? It's a fairy tale church. The dogmatic priest or father of the church would be by necessity less dogmatic, because you cannot be here to, too much of a preacher in the austere, judgmental way inside such a building. You just can't. Although the interior is a little more, maybe, I don't know. I think maybe he was not allowed to, or I don't know, the benches are not in the spirit of Hundertwasser. I don't know. But look at the outside. Now, in certain religions, this would be considered sacrilegious. How could you bring these colors to the building and, this kind of plastic work? No, and no again. But I do feel that the interior is not quite, they probably didn't allow him, it doesn't matter how open-minded they were. Okay, towards the outside, I guess, but here you see a certain strictness, which is, I mean, this is after all a straight line, isn't it? And so is this one. I imagine he couldn't convince, you know, the client, so to speak, to build a little differently. Even this is not really in his spirit. But towards the outside, it's more, you know, humane and less strict. And we can only salute this. And he mimicked here, you know, this is something to make you reflect on the fragility of human life, even though it's just painted. But a nice touch, I would say. Switzerland, he built a market hall, market place. Look at this, it's like similar to the one on the highway. But this is in Switzerland. Why did they commission Hundertwasser? Because they have plenty of architects in Switzerland. Well, because again, they welcome other ideas. Well, I imagine he only sketched a strategy for how the building should be built. You cannot make, you know, working drawings for such a project where every detail is drawn properly. He probably, yes, envisioned a strategy, and he had his, you know, workers maybe traveling from one country to another and working together. Another work in Germany. A similar kind of work, of course. Yes, he, you know, Hundertwasser envisioned a different world. This is a vision of a different world, not like our world as we know it. But one thing is for sure, it would be highly perverse to have dreams, you know, with a T-square and a rectangle. I mean, to be so-called drone with a T-square and a rectangle. No, in the dreams, at least, unless it's a nightmare, or you, I don't know, you have some kind of a perversion of your unconscious world where you employ, where you draw your dreams with perfectly right angles or something like this. No, I think in the dream, in the world of dreams, there are no straight lines. And that's why dreams and the so-called the world of the unconscious are so uncomfortable for the conscious one, ourselves, because we cannot control them. You know, they are not straight, so to speak. They are complicated, a little bit like his architect. Look at this, you know, it is in a way amazing. Amazing that it was built. Quixote Winery in the United States is the only building in the United States, 1998, 1998. It's a winery. I like it. I mean, it's similar to the other buildings, two other buildings that we saw in a way, but they probably also make a lot of money because they are touristic destinations, these buildings. Everything is an invention. I mean, just try to detail this, you know, to make a drawing just of this vertical element here. And it's an artistic work. It's a creation in itself. Not to speak about the other things. I think this man really enjoyed himself conceiving these buildings. Osaka. He arrived in Japan too, another incineration plant in Osaka, in Japan. Look at this. I wonder what Adao Ando thought of it. After all, he lives and works in Osaka. But what Hundertwasser did is so very different from what Hundertwasser did, isn't it? Is it bad? I don't think so. I like it actually. And it doesn't have the predictability and the viciousness in a way of, so-called common postmodernism. This is an uncommon postmodernism. I mean, yes, it is built around that time, but it has, I mean, look at this, for God's sake. I mean, what architect in his or her mind would do something like this? And this is what Hundertwasser did. And this is what, I mean, look at the building here. Look at the building here. Look at this bridge or whatever here. It's a different world. And yet Osaka invited him and commissioned him and built what he envisioned. Bravo to Osaka. You see, they are open-minded. Of course, there was the, because he became famous, but I like the fact that, you know, a very different society with a very different culture and aesthetics, with a very different vision of modernism, still welcomed Hundertwasser. Bravo to them. And bravo, of course, to Hundertwasser. New Zealand, 1999, 1 year before he died, it's a toilet. a public toilet, of course. But look what's at the top here, you know, this wild nature. Nice. Very nice. Why one shouldn't be joyous when going to the toilet? Or returning from the toilet. And I think the building is, the structure is conducive in this sense. Now they have a lot of toilets designed by famous architects in Japan. Tadao Ando did one as well, of course. I think they are less spirited than what we see here. This is my opinion. Environmental railway station in Germany. It was finalized before he died. It does look a little bit like a railway station. Magdeburg, Germany. I don't know what he built here, but it was built after his death. Look at this, it's, can you imagine that actually people in their minds, after the author died, built this work, as you see it. And it looks like he was alive when it was built, but no, he was not, which shows clearly that the impact he had transcended the lifespan himself had. Magdeburg, Germany. And it's not the smallest, block of flats. No, it's not. Well, many people probably would say it's mad. This is the work of a madman. And the client must have been mad and everybody was mad. Please don't forget, on the 19th of December, that is 4 days from now, I will talk about mad architects. or Mad Rhapsody, because this is the title of a book was just published by Rizzoli Electa about Mad Architects, Mayan Song, China. If you are in love with architecture or otherwise, you must be mad. Only if you do not love, you are not mad. But if you love, it's unavoidable. You have to be mad. In fact, I forgot who said, if you are not mad, it means you are not in love. You have to be mad. Love without madness is not really love. Look at this building. Bravo to Hundertwasser and bravo to Magdeburg that they built his fantasy work, his dream. What is this? In the Netherlands, he built also in the Netherlands. This man did a lot of work, and I think he died at 72. So still, if he lived until he was 90, he probably would have covered the whole earth, or every country in the world would have had at least one building by Hundertwasser. This reminds me, it might even be, I don't know if it's his work or Niki de Saint-Phalle, a brilliant French artist who built herself in the same spirit. This might be Niki de Saint-Phalle or someone imitating her work. She built a beautiful, beautiful tarot garden. Ah, we need the artists. We need Hundertwasser. We need Niki de Saint-Phalle. We need the madness of art. Without the madness of art, our life would be totally gray and banal and unlivable, actually. The nature always there in its beautiful and humble way. Germany again, God, 10 years after he died. Look at this. This is truly a phenomenon. I mean, yes, it's like a movement, the Hundertwasser movement. It keeps going on, keeps growing. Well, I confess, for my own taste, my personal taste, not everything is very, very attractive to me, but this is really not the point. The point is that he's fighting our world with something else, and that something else should be considered, I would say, seriously. Okay, let's stop a little bit now.